Thank you very much for giving me time here. I learned about this opportunity on Monday, and so some of my slides are perhaps a little rougher than I would normally be satisfied with, but it is such an honor to be here with two of my scientific inspirations, one you just heard, and Anna Soto. I've known both these scientists for a long time now, and their work is world class and should be informing EFSA and the FDA, but is not. So, Bisphenol A, mistakes and opportunities. I'm going to have three areas to cover here. Where has the FDA gone wrong? And I think a similar analysis could be said about EFSA, although I'm not nearly as versed in EFSA's decision making as I am in FDA's. So where has the FDA gone wrong? What are the risks we encounter when we attempt to use existing substitutes for bisphenol A? And third, how can we get out of this conundrum where what we heard from Nestle was an absolutely accurate picture of the huge challenge that we face with all these chemicals out there and not the ability to go through them one by one. I have been working with a team of computational chemists and biologists and a variety of skill sets for about the last 8 years on this last point, that there may be another way, another path forward. We absolutely need to be continuing to work to improve EFSA and FDA's decisions, but there might be a way to help companies make money by designing things differently, and that's what this last section is about. So, just to put this in context, we are living in an era of hormonally related epidemics worldwide. And there's evidence for each of the health endpoints on this list that endocrine disruption is contributing some portion of these disease burdens. And it varies from probably small to quite substantial. So bear that in mind. We're not talking about irrelevant issues. We're talking about massive assaults on human health. The World Health Organization, actually last year, reached that conclusion. They published this study along with the United Nations Environment Program. And this study had several central conclusions. The overarching conclusion is that endocrine disruption is a global public health threat. In the document, you can find a series of key points. Many endocrine disruption and endocrine-related disorders are on the rise, and it's happening way too fast to be changes in gene frequency. It's environmental. Right now, they estimate there are about 800 chemicals in common use that are known to disrupt endocrine function, but most chemicals of those 80,000 that are in use, they haven't been tested for these endpoints, period. So how many more than 800 there are, we don't have a clue. We do know that human and wildlife exposure is ubiquitous. Exposure to these compounds, as Angel noted, in people is virtually unavoidable, and that's true for most of life. There are legions of studies from the lab, from wildlife, and from epidemiology that show plausible links between exposures to endocrine disrupting compounds and that list of endocrine-related health effects, which are now epidemic. The World Health Organization concluded that the risks that they identified due to EDCs may be significantly underestimated because of all the unknowns that still reside within the system, especially how many other chemicals there are and how many endpoints have we not been looking at carefully. But they also conclude that there are significant opportunities today to work on preventing some of those epidemics, lowering the disease burden by reducing exposures. So, on to BPA specifically. Thank you, Angel, for that wonderful introduction. You saved me a lot of time. One of the common uses of BPA is to line food cans. That's where a lot of the exposure comes from. FDA maintains that most, if not all, exposure is dietary. That's not true, but a lot of it is. So here is FDA's core assumption. Exposures to BPA are too low to affect health, and therefore BPA is safe. That's their central conclusion. How did they get there? Well, they think about dietary exposure, ingestion, and they think about the fact that once something is in the stomach and passes into the liver, once BPA is, most of it, a very, very large fraction of it, is processed metabolically, it's conjugated, and at least according to current theory, conjugated BPA has no ability to interact with the estrogen receptor. So dietary exposure deconjugates BPA, makes it inactive, means there isn't enough in people to cause health effects. A second central assumption is that as you look at the many studies of people, both purely to measure what's in them, as well as to look for associations between BPA levels in serum and a variety of health outcomes, the FDA has concluded that any unconjugated active BPA in serum can't be trusted. It's an artifact of some artificial contamination. Somewhere in the process of gathering the sample, you got BPA into your samples, and therefore what you're measuring is not real. Some more factors contributing to that assumption. FDA maintains that many animal studies and in vitro studies like on hills are poorly designed for regulatory purposes. They aren't GLP. They use the wrong delivery methods. They use assays that FDA has never heard of because they haven't heard of them. FDA also maintains that contamination in animal experiments is unavoidable, and therefore low-dose results are unreliable. You can't believe them if you see them. And lastly, a core assumption here is that the FDA assumes that you can use high-dose tests to reveal when low-dose issues might be a problem. If you don't see it at high doses, you won't see it at low doses. Well, you just saw Onhell's data reject this last assumption, but I'll give you an example in a few moments. So why is this wrong? Why? What's misleading the FDA? And there are a couple of key things. First of all, there are data dealing with the membrane system, the receptor system that Onhell described on the cell membrane, in which the inactive form of BPA can be as powerful as the active form. So conjugation doesn't necessarily eliminate the ability of BPA in you to interact with receptors. Secondly, BPA that's been inactivated can be reactivated by other metabolic processes, especially where you don't want it, in the placenta and in the fetus. And thirdly, there are a host of misleading experiments which actually lie at the core of EFSA and FDA's assessments, which make the following mistake. Now, I said they assume that the primary pathway of exposure is dietary, but they use experiments that are called gavage, both in a human form of gavage, where you take a capsule, you put BPA in the capsule and you put it into the stomach, or you take a gavage tube and push it down the throat of a rat or mouse and you put the BPA in the stomach. And what that does is it bypasses one of the most sensitive tissues via which nitroglycerin, estradiol, and other compounds can be absorbed, and that's in the mouth. This leads to a very large mistake in FDA's calculations of what we should expect to see in people. So what they do is they calculate the ratio of active to inactivated BPA. And if you go in through the stomach, as I just described using gavage, most of it is inactivated, it's conjugated. So then you wind up with high or low levels of active BPA compared to inactivated BPA in serum. That's the prediction if that's the proper right route of exposure. But what many experiments and measurements in people see is relatively high amounts of active BPA compared to inactive BPA in human serum. Okay? That's what happens when BPA goes in through the oral mucosa sublingually, like the administration of nitroglycerin and other medicines. So the FDA has based a set of criteria about whether or not to accept evidence as to the reality of BPA in people based on the assumption that these artificial routes of exposure are representative of how people experience it. But that's not the case. Sublingual exposure is very important for BPA. So, frankly, there are a series of things that related to this in which FDA's incompetence, scientific incompetence, has been clearly demonstrated. First, there has been a study over the last several years called a round-robin study in which unknown samples are sent to different laboratories with unknown amounts of BPA in them. And the challenge to each of the laboratories is to come back with the answer, how much was in sample A versus sample B versus sample C. FDA participated in that lab, in that experiment, for a while and then withdrew. And we have subsequently learned that while four of the five labs that were participating could accurately solve that puzzle, the FDA was not able to do it. So they withdrew from the experiment. This has now been published. And we just learned a few months ago, thanks to a paper by the FDA, that even in animal experiments, they have contaminated animals, artificially contaminated animals, that they're using to test for the effects of low doses of BPA. And that's just not possible endocrinologically. If you have contamination in your controls, you cannot reach any conclusion about the experiments, and yet that's what the FDA tried to do in published studies. If that study had been submitted to an endocrinological journal, it would have been rejected as completely unscientific. Whoops. So I think we're in a place where we can now recognize that this is a major setback for the FDA. And here's the key part. They've used circular logic and false assumptions at the core of their decision that levels of BPA in people are too low to have an effect. They calculated the ratio of active to inactive BPA that we should expect in people on the basis of false assumptions. They then threw out all the epi studies that had the wrong ratios, which actually other science says are entirely plausible. They threw out those measurements that indicated high levels of BPA in people, and then they, without those in the sample set, in the data set, they were able to say, well, there aren't high enough levels of BPA in people to cause effects. You see the circularity of that? The FDA, in this instance, is using its assumptions to determine whether or not it accepts data, which is not scientific. You use data to test assumptions. So that's that's the core pathway they followed to reach the conclusion that the levels in people are too low to cause harm. They also have problems with the way that they've analyzed animal data. Bottom line, when you measure people for BPA, and you look at their patterns of exposure to people in BPA, both dietary and other types of exposure, which include dermal, a single exposure per day, which is what's used in animal experiments, does not match what people experience. And in fact, the FDA rejected what the scientists in this room would say is the most realistic delivery method, which comes much closer to simulating what people experience. And that method of exposure are implanted osmotic pumps, a method of exposure that Anna Soto pioneered. These studies have all been thrown out by the FDA in their risk assessments because they say exposure is dietary, therefore implanted pumps don't matter, But here's the key thing. Anna's working with fetuses, right? She's looking at developmental effects. Well, that fetus doesn't care how the BPA gets into its mom. What matters is how much is in the serum. That's what matters. So the FDA has used faulty logic to reject Anna's data, which is extraordinary. In fact, if you use Anna's data to calculate the ADI, it's 20,000 times lower, 20,000 times lower than the FDA's current estimate. So I want to go on to this particular piece of the flawed logic they use, which builds on the non-monotonic curves that Angel showed. This is a graphic demonstration of part of a non-monotonic curve. This is work done by the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. And you can see that grotesque obesity is involved. That animal was exposed to one part per billion of an obesogen. BPA is an obesogen, not in this particular experiment, but Anna, for example, has produced obese mice using BPA. There was no difference in the caloric intake rate of the animal, of the control versus the experimental. There was no difference in activity levels, and it's the same strain of mice. So here's my question for you. At one part per billion, this obesogen causes grotesque obesity. What if it were 1,000 parts per billion? The experimental mouse would have been scrawnier. It would have lost weight compared to the experimental mouse. So at high doses, the animal loses weight. At low doses, grotesque obesity is caused. That's precisely analogous to the inverted U curves that Angel was showing in his presentation. But let me take you through a thought experiment with another EDC. In this case, it's tamoxifen, which, as most of you know, is a drug used to treat breast cancer. And it's relevant in Switzerland generally because as women take tamoxifen to treat breast cancer, they don't metabolize it all. Some of it makes it back into the water system, into the sewage system. And now Switzerland has a law that says you have to figure out how to get it out and at what level it's safe to allow it still in. This whole issue of pharmaceuticals in sewage water and its passage into drinking water. So we're going to do a thought experiment here, which how much tamoxifen can be in that water for it to be safe for people. So here you have the control, growth of a breast cancer tumor, parts per billion, parts per thousand. And this curve up here shows why tamoxifen is valuable. At high doses, it suppresses the growth of the breast tumor, okay? So let's do the experiment as a toxicologist would. You start at the high doses and you work down the dose response curve. These two are significantly different from the control. These aren't. So you use that to determine the no observed adverse effect level, okay? You then build in safety factors for a factor of 10 because kids aren't little adults, a factor of 10 because people are different, a factor of 10 because animals are, because there's individual variation in people. And you reach what is called the safe level, the reference dose. And you never test at that level. No toxicologist would ever test that because you're 1,000-fold beneath the low L. Why bother? It couldn't possibly cause a biological effect. Well, Wade Welshins at the University of Virginia decided to extend the dose response curve. That's what it looks like. Precisely, and this didn't have to be, but precisely at the reference dose, tamoxifen induces growth of the breast tumor. It's an estrogen at that level. This is exactly like Angel's curves, where you've got an inverted U dose response curve. In fact, physicians know about this. It's called the tamoxifen flare. When you treat a woman for breast cancer with tamoxifen, you get them past that level of tamoxifen as quickly as possible because it's actually painful because it stimulates tumor growth. Okay, so let's use these new data, these new points here to determine what the, and the standard toxicological procedure to determine what is the safe dose of tamoxifen. There's the true Noel, at least according to Welshon's data. And then with the safety factors, that's the safe level. people cleaning up tamoxifen out of Swiss sewage have a challenge. But we need to keep tamoxifen on the market because it's really important. So, we actually Anna and I and a group of scientists did a review of the frequency of non-monotonic dose response curves in the scientific literature, specifically focused on endocrine disruption, and we found, in fact, them quite abundant. If you look for them, you find them. They're there. This is published in Endocrine Reviews, which is the biggest journal in the field of endocrinology. And I'm proud to say we've increased their impact factor, the editor tells us, by about at least 10%. It was already the highest in the field. Linda Birnbaum, the director of the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, commented in an editorial on our paper, basically said, there's no question that non-monotonicity occurs. We've got to do more work to understand exactly how and why and where, and then how to incorporate it into regulatory processes. We found several hundred examples of different non-monotonic responses in the literature. You can see that BPA clearly has non-monotonic responses. So if you step back and ask, what's going on? How? In this paper, we discuss six different biological mechanisms that are known to produce non-monotonicity. I'm not going to go into them now, but what I want you to think about is one central general concept. Classical toxicology has been focused on how high levels of contaminants overwhelm the body's defenses. The work by Anna and by Angel, they're looking at ways that some compounds hijack the control of gene expression and other biological activities at profoundly low levels. And it is a fundamental challenge to how we move forward with dealing with the problem that we heard about this morning, the sheer number of chemicals that are out there. What fraction of them are non-monotonic, and how do we incorporate that into our regulatory approaches? Second thing I said I was going to talk about, how are we doing on time? Okay. Less? Okay. So, substitution challenge, you want to replace BPA, and lots of people do, and people are making money selling products for replacing BPA because moms want to buy things that don't have BPA in them. This market's growing very rapidly. You cannot simply go to the chemical shelf and grab something and assume that because it's not BPA, it's safe. We have a whole series of examples where that's happened. Because the chemicals that are on that chemical shelf today were designed and tested using the same flawed criteria that led to the bad thing in the first place. And usually we know much less about that replacement than we know about the thing we're trying to replace. This is not a new problem. We've got many examples where bad substitutes have been brought onto the market to replace something that was itself bad. PCBs, PBDEs, various flame, there are generations of flame retardants where we've learned one after the other that they were bad. I want to talk about one current effort with BPA briefly, and that's the use of BPS, which is chemically, structurally very similar to BPA, not identical. And so BPA, probably one of the larger sources of exposure to BPA today is probably paper receipts, thermal paper, both dermally and orally. How many people do you see putting their paper receipt in their mouth at the mouth of the fast food joint? They're getting a big dose. So when we first started working on this around 2007, and we did some market samples and discovered that about 50% of the thermal paper in the U.S. in the Boston area were not BPA, which I thought was great news because it meant that there was a commercially viable replacement in the marketplace. Could someone deal with So we were happy to see there was a commercially viable replacement, but then we asked, well, what is it? And it turned out it was BPS. And we looked at the toxicological literature on BPS, and there were two papers about BPS instead of the over 1,000 that were then available for BPA. So we actually organized some funding for one of the leading researchers in the world, Cheryl Watson, who works on how BPA and other estrogens affect the cell membrane receptors that Angel talked about. We got her money so she could ask, is BPA similar, BPS similar to BPA? And it is just as powerful as BPS at working those cell membrane receptors. Bad replacement. So how do you deal with this? Well, we all know about the three R's, right? Reduce, reuse, recycle. I think there's a fourth R that's probably even more important, and that's redesign. And so I've been working with a team, as I mentioned briefly earlier, a team of computational chemists, green chemists, reproductive biologists, specialists in endocrine disruption over the last 8 years to try and ask, can we put together an intellectual framework that will help chemists at the bench as they are designing new materials, new compounds, test early on whether it's likely to be an endocrine disruptor, and then use that information to guide product design. Do I continue to work with this thing that looks like BPS, or do I just don't invest any more money in that product? I think that in parallel with regulatory action, this creation of a tool to allow chemists to make money by designing things that are inherently safer is a very important parallel path forward. We had about 35 scientists participating in this. The two on the outside are two of the world's leading green chemists, Terry Collins and John Werner. And the person in the center is from National Institute of Environmental Sciences. We had great participation by NIEHS in this process. We call it the tiered endocrine disruptor protocol. It's voluntary. This is not about regulation. It let us keep lawyers out of the room. Sorry, Dan. But it meant the discussion was about science and how you solve scientific problems instead of about how you protect your product. It's not about current replacements for the reasons I said before. It's economically efficient because it allows the company to avoid spending money on products that ultimately are going to be a big problem for them. It's driven by endocrinological principles. If you want to prevent endocrine disruption, there are a series of ways you have to build your tests, your assays. And it's designed to evolve with science. If you look at the regulatory tests that are used today, most of them, they're certainly all from before 2000. Think of how much science has advanced since just the year 2000. Many of them are from the 1950s and are irrelevant to that collection of human health effects that are endocrinologically driven. We published this 2 years ago in the Royal Society of Chemistry's journal, Green Chemistry. There's a DOI there. I'd be happy to give it to anyone who wants it. It involves a tiered approach. We do think that there is value from what you were telling us about today. Computational-based assessments are fast. Unfortunately, right now, they're not ready for prime time. There are too many false negatives, especially with endocrine disruption. We have been working with the docking methods in addition to QSAR. QSARs can be very misleading on endocrine disruption. Docking models, which we call pocket models, where you look at the actual way the molecule interacts with the receptor, they're good, but there are almost 50 nuclear receptors, and they're probably, three or four docking models right now. And so we got a long ways to go before we can deal with the full complement of receptors involved in guiding the endocrine system. So we put together a hierarchy that goes from computational, we start there. If you get a big negative sign, stop there. But then you can go through high throughput screening, some tools using whole cell assays that don't just focus on single receptors at a time, but look at integrated signals. You've got to move into live animal testing, because we're talking about integrated systems that if you use too reductionist approach, you'll miss all sorts of things. And finally, ultimately, you'll have to do some mammalian testing. But you only do those on the few molecules that make it all the way through those others, so you avoid wasting money. Anyway, we have a problem in front of us, a big public health problem. we can see several pathways to beginning to tackle that. One of them is acting on the science to change regulations to reflect the science. And the other is helping chemists make money by designing inherently safer materials. Thank you.